Lord, you are holy and mighty and worthy, Lord. Lord, we bless your name. Lord, we come to you. Lord, prepare our hearts. Lord, may all of us, may we all have ears willing to hear, hearts that are soft and willing to receive the truth and the life and the grace of your word. Blessed be your name, Lord. Thank you for this time. Thank you for your faithful ones here and across this world, Lord. Bless them in your name.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord. While we're standing, I'm going to read something. Hallelujah. Together with you and bring out your Bible. Three scriptures, Lord, give to me. While we worship, we said we read this portion again. We mentioned this yesterday during the meeting with King of Brother Sister, but let's turn to this one. Hallelujah. 12 chapter for Hebrew, the book Hebrews 22 said, "For you have come to Mount Zion. You have come to Mount Zion, to the heavenly Jerusalem, the city of the living God. You have come to thousands upon thousands of angels in joyful assembly, to the church of the firstborn, whose names are written in heaven. You have come to God, the judge of all men, to the spirits of righteous men made perfect, to Jesus, the mediator of a new covenant, and to the sprinkled blood that speak a better word than the blood of Abel. See to it that you do not refuse him who speaks. If they did not escape when they refused him who warned them on earth, how much less will we if we turn away from him who warns us from heaven? And then time, his voice shook the earth. But now he has promised. Once more, I will shake not only the earth, but also the heavens." The words "once more" indicate the removing of what can be shaken. That is, quite a thing, so that what can't be shaken may remain. Therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom that can be shaken, let's be thankful and so worship God acceptably with reverence and awe, for our God is a consuming fire. Well, while reading this, I'm mentioning some scriptures. I encourage everybody visit the teaching when it's published of yesterday, and well, some new revelation came to me while I was sharing, but here is in Daniel 7:9. "As I looked, thrones were set in place. In the ancient days took his seat, to his throne. His clothing was like as white as snow. The hero's head was white like a bull." Hallelujah. "His throne was a flame with a fire. And his wheels were all blaze. A river of fire was a flame coming out from before him. Thousands upon thousands attended him. 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. The court was sitting, and the book opened. Then I continued to watch because the boastful words, the horn was speaking. I kept looking until the beast was slain, and his body destroyed and thrown into the blazing fire. The other beast has been stripped of their authority and were allowed to live for a pure time. In my vision, at night I looked, and there before me was one like as a solemn man, coming with the clouds of heaven. He approached ancient days and was led into his presence. He was given authority, glory, sovereign power. All peoples, nations, and men of every language worshipped him. His dominion is everlasting dominion that will not pass away, and the kingdom is one that will never be destroyed. Well, let's turn to Psalm 52. This psalm was given to me, but pretty soon it was a nudging, and with my even refusal to read it. What happened is that God continued giving me the same number everywhere I look. Weather, rays, everywhere is 52. So bars, everywhere, my 52 is so consecutively for about 2 or 3 days. So I said, Lord, okay, I'm going to read it. So finally, I said, I'm reading it. And I was not, when I read it, I was not happy with the content a little bit, because the Lord, I don't want to share with anybody. And the Lord then this morning gave you Psalm 92. He said, read Psalm 52 and compare the two Psalms. Now that was in 2 minutes. My bar was 92%. And I was scratching my head, Lord, I'm not going to do it. So finish a little bit this sharing. It's 9:11. The Lord said 11 plus together 2. So it's my little sign for you. So I look at it. The Lord said, "Have you seen? I give you the same image. You know, same psalm almost." So I said, "What?" So I read it. Actually, have the same imagery almost. So we read it. This is amazing what God teaches us. So I don't recommend this to everybody. I'm just talking about me being slow to learn. I'm really slow to learn. And let's turn to this Psalm 52. Psalm 52 was a very interesting psalm. I don't want to visit it because I'm teaching on David's life. So I want to do some study about it. You know, so Psalm 52, let's see. For the direct music of Michigan of David, when Doeg, the Edomites, had gone to Saul and told him, David had gone to the house of Ahimelech. Ahimelech was the Levite, the high priest, descendants of Aaron, who basically acting in that order from before Samuel, who was there in the house of God, what is the name? It's Eli.
Eli.
It is two sons. So that's order. So, and then Samuel was called out by God. So Samuel went on, have his own ministry. In a sense, Samuel went his home. He stayed at his home. He offered sacrifice to God at his home. So Ahimelech stayed in the place where Joshua held the altar, and the ark when that time was lost in Eli's time, you know, on hearing it. Eli died, remember that? You know, so, and so that's happened in the Israelites' religious life as well, historical life as a people, national life as a people. It's such a change that is dramatic, you know, it's like the ark was lost, you know. So was the real life with the Philistine run them over, you know. So, but never heard of before is that the priesthood was lost. So in this time, God raised up David through Samuel's ministry as well. And so David on the run saw the first king, pursued David, and the guy, his name is Doeg, is an Edomite. Edomites is a slave, you know. So, and Saul held this slave as a head shepherd. So basically in charge all the wealth in those days, say counted your sheep and cattle as your real wealth. Mm-hmm. So he in charge the whole wealth of Saul, basically, who land his whole herds, you know. So, and he continued bring, you can think about it, he is rich, he's also a little powerful, and a new kingdom come about. And he bring sacrifice to the host of God. There's no ark, so he went where? He didn't go to Samuel, am I right? He went to this high priest place. While David was wrong, he went there, where the sword of Goliath was sword. And he went there, he asked for bread to eat. He also get a sword from Abimelech. And so this Doeg was there, saw David there. Then he bring the report to Saul. Said, you know, basically the priest Abimelech has aided David's escape. Knowing that, this, you know, knowing that David as if he's Saul's enemy, actually not true. This the high priest, David lied to the high priest, am I right? So, and so this whole story played out, and when David heard this, now continues that Saul sent man himself persecute, go to this place, Abinadab, where the house of the Lord is, and then he asked where David is. He was so angry, so mad. He killed the priest. The priest basically said, I don't know, you know, we just aided. He's not your best soldier, you know, is that not your son-in-law, you know? How we know him, right? So, and so it was just like, you know, so angry, so mad, he said, told his soldier, kill everybody in the house of the Lord, all the priests. And no soldier raised up the sword. So this evil man, Doeg, said, he then told Doeg, go ahead, do it. So it was a terrible because, you know, first they are priests, second they are the own people, am I right? You don't have Edomites, which is the enemy god, to do that, you know? So there's no honor, it's totally breaking down of the order of the house of God. So there is no restraint on Saul's side, no fear, absolutely no. So this whole thing, then Abiathar is a son of Amalek, carried the ephod, took off, the only one left, and went to the wilderness with David. And David heard the story, he wrote this song. He heard all his friends, all the, it's more than the people died, the good people aided him died. It's a whole will of God is overthrown. You know, this wicked king just have no fear in God. And he was one instrumental in causing all this to happen, you know. So he don't know what to say. He don't know what to do. You can think about the trouble he had. It was, he treated Saul like his father. He treated the priest with highest honor, you know? So this is a place where he draw support, draw encouragement, you know, draw honor from, you know? Draw security from. And then everything turned against him. And this evil man was instrument, or the evil instrument in the hand of Saul, am I right? So did all these things, caused all this havoc, and lead Saul into more madness and wickedness. So, in 52, then he get rich, am I right, by doing it. More powerful by doing it. So, Psalm 52, now we get the context, am I right, see what's going on. So why do you boast of evil? You're a mighty man, means a man of great power. Why do you boast all day long, you who are disgraced in the eyes of God? Your tongues plus destruction is like a sharpened razor, you who practice deceit. You love evil rather than good, falsehood rather than speaking the truth. You love every harmful word, you deceitful tongue. You deceitful tongue. So, idol, dog, is this place, is evil instrument. Am I right? A evil man with the wrong heart, with the wrong counsel, and go about doing evil things. Surely. And David don't understand why God bring this enemy to him. Yeah. Cause all those, you know, cause tragedies in his life. And he consoled God, God revealed to him in this psalm. It's a psalm why he worshiped, God revealed to him. And declared what God revealed to him. So how you deal with the evil, this psalm can give you a template.
Yeah.
Surely, God will bring you down to everlasting ruin. He will snatch you up and tear you from your tent. He will uproot you from the land of the living. The righteous will see and fear, so he knows the future now of this man. They will laugh at him, saying, "For now is the man who did not make God his stronghold, but trust in his own great wealth, and grew strong by destroying others." But I am, David was a, like a dog, am I chased everywhere, you know? I am, so he sees the future now. And it's more than any future, a good future for life, am I right? Rather the internal future, because that man is putting internal perspective, am I right? He will be internally ruined, judged by God. But I am like an olive tree. You can read on Zechariah 4, speaking about two olive branch, olive tree, am I right? So I am an olive tree flourishing in the host of God. I trust in God's unfailing love forever and ever. Amen. I will praise you forever for what you've done. In your name, I will hope. Amen. Mm-hmm. For your name is good. I will praise you in the presence of your holy ones. Psalm 92. No asterisk. It should be this psalm, but let's look at it. Psalm 92, for the Sabbath day. It's good to praise the Lord and move music to your name, O Most High, to proclaim your love in the morning and your faithfulness at night. To the music, the 10-string lyre, to the melody of the harp. For you make me glad by your deeds, O God. I sing for your joy and the works of your hands. How great are your works, O God, and how profound your thoughts. The senseless man don't know, fools don't understand. Then though the wicked spring like grass, and evildoers flourish, they will be forever destroyed. But you, O Lord, I exhort it forever. For surely your enemies, O Lord, surely your enemy will perish, all evildoer will be scattered. You have exalted my horn like that of a wild ox. Fine oil have been poured upon me. You know that's happened to David in real life, am I right? Hallelujah. My eyes have seen the defeat of my adversaries. My ears have heard the rout of the wicked ones. Now, putting into context. For us, it was never about another wicked man, or wicked policy, or wicked forces, am I right? For us, it was this devil, am I right? Our true adversary. In the spirit realm, in we, our soul realm, try to put us into a place disarray, am I right? Hallelujah. Amen. And we need to learn that his feet is sealed. He has lost the battle, even concerning us, as we hold on to God and endure the different seasons of life. You know, the shallow Christians tell us, God, if you're blessed by God, this is going to happen, that is going to happen. We know one thing, and God is going to bless us, is that we have the internal hope in us, regardless of what happens in this life. Amen. That's the only thing we need to use as a standard. Anything else is shaking, eventually will shake up. Amen. Hallelujah. Shaky ground is a sandy ground. Amen. Hallelujah. The righteous then, what is that? The righteous will flourish like a palm tree. Amen. Hallelujah. Like a cedar of Lebanon. Can you believe that? Hallelujah. Planted in the house of the Lord, they will flourish in the courts of our God. Amen. 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 They will still bear fruit in old age, and they will stay fresh and green, prickly me. And I'm singing loud, right? The Lord is upright. He is my rock, and there is no wickedness in him. Hallelujah. Let's pray for us. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. I'm going to do some teaching today as well, so thank you, Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. Pray for us. Amen.
Father, we thank you. Lord, we thank you that you have brought us into your house, that you make known your ways. We thank you for your love and your goodness, that you are sovereign Lord over everything, every detail of this world, tracked by you, understood and planned by you. Lord, we thank you that you bring every detail of our lives, even those, especially those painful things, for a profit, that we would learn and grow and mature to be mighty trees, growing strong in your spirit. Lord, that you have made this great forest, that your glory has, is, and will fill us, Lord. Lord, we are yours. Glorify your name.
Yes.
Bless the time, Lord.
Amen. 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 Hallelujah. Amen. Let's get some serious business going on. John, I don't think I'm serious. I'm a very serious man. Especially in one of you. I want to be serious. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Bless the Lord. God's business, seriousness.
Yeah, amen.
All joy and seriousness. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Let's turn to it and follow me, because I'm going to just read and stop somewhere if you allow me. So we're going to start, I think John M. Wright, Tim finished the first session concerning the foundational teachings.
Mm-hmm.
So we're going to continue. Okay, so we're going to another way down.
Are the pins not joining us?
Sorry. Yeah, not today. So and to have the follow up. So the first portion we was talking about basically the prophets. I'm actually thinking about it like a book, have outlines speaking of things, you know. Not of things have been given the details, but I do want to, in this series, talking the foundational things of God, or the life in the kingdom of God. Now, also the ministry of God. I will talk about it more, but allow me to go on with the frame of thinking or frame of teaching that I outlined here. So we're in the second session, and I recommend take to your heart of these teachings, because I believe there's every reason this teaching is close by. And need to be more. Hallelujah, hallelujah. So, the title I give to it is Building God's House is Through What? through discipleship. This is a whole series for this few sessions. We'll talk about centered on one thing. Why discipleship is paramount for us to grasp the importance of it. And also, with that, because discipleship is defined differently, I use the word genuine discipleship, it's, you know, Pharisee disciple, their disciple in a certain way, John the Baptist did that. And right, so we know Apollos was a disciple, for example, with John the Baptist. And Aquila and her husband's name?
Priscilla.
Priscilla, yeah, the husband was Aquila. Priscilla. You know, it's basically two simple persons, and right? They're not as deep in the scriptures, whether in the traditions of the priest or the Levites, and right? Whatever that tradition is, the Pharisaic, whatever that sect. Apollos getting was, this two simple person draw him aside and said, let's explain to you a more excellent way. The word we use in English word is more excellent. That is our word. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Think about the word Greek word will mean. What other language will mean, right? Unless there is absolutely comparison between the two, right? Distinctly. Different. You don't call something excellent, am I right? Mm. Compared to other things, they're already good, you know? And convict a man who is a full passionate, am I right? About what he know and doing the thing what he did, like Apollos did, and two simple person draw him aside. They don't even know much about the scriptures. They don't know. They were not even involved in the center of the culture, am I right? They were in the Greek world, in the Roman world, and to tell this guy who was discipled by John the Baptist said, let us tell you something much, 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 much better. That's excellent. If before you have iron, let us give you gold. So do you understand that? The difference, right? I mean, when somebody said, oh, you tell me my iron is not good, yeah, give me good. If I see good, the value good, I will instantly discard iron, am I right? Yeah. I mean, comparatively speaking about, we know what the truth, am I right? So that's what the Apollos did. When he see the good, the precious value of the gospel, through simple people presented to him. So what discipleship? Discipleship, the word of the Lord, is more precious than God. Mm-hmm. Some said, okay, we know that, but let's look at Peter, what he said. Peter used to be almost one disciple of John the Baptist, am I right? Mm-hmm. So, turn to First Peter 1:18. He said, for you know, that, amen, that you know it is not with a perishable thing. Just as a silver or gold that you were redeemed from the empty wheel of life. What wheel of life? Peter knows. It's the empty wheel of life. Handed down to you from your forefathers. He's not talking about merely Gentiles, he's talking about Jews, right? I mean, steep in the tradition. Everybody thinks they're worshiping the Almighty God. You know? Mm-hmm. Everybody thinks they're knowledgeable about the will of God. They did their best. You know? He said it's empty. But with the precious blood of Jesus Christ, the Lamb without blemish or defect, he has chosen you before the creation of the world. But he was chosen before the creation of the world, Christ Jesus. But it was revealed in this last time, revealed, made known. Am I right? Hallelujah. For your sake. What did he know? Through him you believe in God, who raised him from the dead, and glorified him, and through your faith hope in God. Hope in God. Now that you have purified yourself by obeying the truth, so that you have a sincere love for your brothers. Love one another deeply from the heart. From where? From the heart. For you have been born again, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable, through the living and enduring word of God. Amen. Hallelujah. The gospel. I like the grass. And all the glory, like the flower of the field, the grass wither and the flowers fall, but the word of the Lord stands forever. And this is the word that the Lord preached to you. With this context, he said, therefore rid yourselves of all malice, all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, slander of every kind, like what? Newborn babies. Hallelujah, like a little one, isn't right? Crave spiritual milk, so that by it you may grow up in your salvation. Now you have taste that the Lord is good. Amen. Turn back with us to this portion. So with it, the word of the Lord, genuine discipleship, we're speaking about the prophet. In the first session, we discussed the prophets, is Haggai, and others. And through them, God declared that it would continue to restore people back to his heaven dwelling place as a spiritual host, or the land host, under his divine order and grace. We also touch on the idea that God, through Jesus Christ, has introduced to us a heavenly order, under which a heavenly tabernacle and ministry is to be installed and put in effect. Amen? Hallelujah. See that? A heavenly tabernacle and a ministry. So we are serving God in where? In the heavenly realms. You have come to Mount Zion, am I right? The heavenly Jerusalem. The assembly of angels and all the righteous spirits and made perfect. Am I right? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The sons of God, the firstborn in his name. Am I right? In his book. Amen. Hallelujah. So that's where we are. That's who we are. That's when Jesus said, I go to my Father to prepare a place for you. And where I am, you will be. Am I right? Hallelujah. The Spirit will lead you. Amen. That's where we are. If you're born again, you belong to this dwelling place, belong to this household, and your citizen is the kingdom. Now, this is the hope, the identity we need to know. And then service, amen, we need to engage with, amen, right? So this is the kind of discipleship is about. What life thereof look like? What mature in that life? Second, how to serve God the Father, the Son, in that order. Amen? Life and order. Am I right? Hallelujah. A lineage and an order of government. Amen? Hallelujah. Let's continue. We will continue this prophetic theme here in order to gain some insight into the reality that our generation, is a weird time. Hallelujah. Now is the time that such a work will be revealed and manifest through his chosen people. The consummation of all ages is coming. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. After that, we'll talk about the we and the pattern, how God will build his house, which is the ministry of the new covenant. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Please bear in mind, this is a huge topic and we'll only mention a few insights that are distinctly relevant to our discussion about discipleship. So the center topic is discipleship. Let's go on. In the year of 538 BCE, the Persian king Cyrus the Great brought about the fall of the Babylonian Empire as recorded in the books of Ezra and Nehemiah. He then gave permission to the Israelites to return to the homeland and rebuild their temple. So this is a historical happening, right? The first of those returned were led by Zerubbabel, And Yeshua, Zerubbabel being the governor, being a descendant of the king, am I right? David's descendants. Yeshua being a descendant of Aaron, being a priest. A Levite. However, because the opposition of the Samaritans, the works rebuilt in the temple was almost abandoned. So God began to speak to Haggai and Zechariah and told them to encourage the people to come back and work on rebuilding the temple. So there were 10 years time this started, but never able to finish. They were so pressed. First, the Samaritans would attack them, am I right? You know, threatening them, they had to defend themselves, remember? And the second is that everybody was so poor, so not able to survive, am I right? So they had to say, we got to do something with our own family, with our own survival. Then, maybe, we can come back to build God's house. So there is a key. And God said, it will not be done like that. So there were reasons they go to exile first. Amen? Hallelujah. The second, there's a reason God permitted them through Cyrus to come back. Yet the people were slow to hear God, slow to identify where they're calling in God. And this is the day's hour. We need acknowledge. This is a great challenge for those who hear God and whether they're willing to answer the call. Many will fall away. Many, the sincere, will be separated from the insincere. Hallelujah. Many will think God is a lie when he said he's going to rebuild his house, he's going to restore his genuine discipleship. Many think, just like they treat Jesus with a contempt, with a disbelief. They could not bear the thoughts that the traditions are the empty ways of life. They could not bear the thought that worldly pursuits have no value in God. The best of their gift, the best effort in God's sight is out of order. Am I right? It's unclean sacrifices. God chose his people, made them holy, set apart, to do a particular thing with a particular way. And he will not have it otherwise. There will be no, how about this, how about that? About it. That this is it. This is the way. This is the time. And this is what he will do. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Now, that's a challenge with those who don't have a heart for God's greater purposes. Have not answered their calling. But for those who are waiting for it, those who have been all their life searching for it, those who have understand the fear and allow God what it means for their own heart, their own life, this will be a great excitement. Am I right? Hallelujah. The honor, the privilege. I mean, who is David? Is everybody a David? Who is Jesus Christ? Who is Peter? Am I right? Not every generation has the privilege to become like them. But we are the chosen generation. Amen. Hallelujah. Let's go on. So a very limiting observation can be made here. One that will give us insight into the pattern of God's work restoration. So there's a way he wants things to be restored. We know the Lord always uses natural historical events to reveal his spiritual work, which is invisible and requires faith and wisdom to discern. Require faith? If you don't believe, you will never pay attention to it. So even, and wisdom, even if you pay attention to it, if you don't have a spiritual life, spiritual illumination, spiritual contest, you are not able to see. You are not able to discern. Amen? The disciples miss it most of the time until the Spirit comes, opens their heart, right? To see what Jesus did, was true when he taught was true. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. This pattern is that God always intended to have his temple or tabernacle installed in the midst of the people before he brings prosperity. Amen. Let me repeat. Before, not after. The human thoughts is when we prosper, everybody have something to offer, we bring the gold, the silver to God's house, then God can do something. And God said, no, if you do and build my house first, I will bless you. This pattern is that God always intends to have his temple, tabernacle, installed in the midst of God's people before he brings prosperity to the land he gives them, even though he has already settled them in the land he promised. Amen? The temple building or the house building is a unique, different way, different set of work and requirements compared to the conquerors and enemy to go to the promised land. Amen? Hallelujah, to possess the land. But if you don't have the land, you will never have the chance to start building the temple. Am I right? But it's different set of work. It's understandably so. Amen? Hallelujah, understandably so. He revealed his desires to the Israelites when after generations of bewilderment and scatteredness, he raised up the kingdom, the kingdom David, and Solomon built him the first temple. He affirmed it by becoming a consuming fire on the altar of sacrifice and filled the whole temple with his glory. Tragically, the priests and kings did not remain wise and faithful before God. In their days, as shown in Ezekiel's vision, they were so corrupted that idols and thieves were found in the practice of the priesthood. Can you believe that? They put idols in their own little rooms, in the temple. In the temple. Not just in their own rooms, in their own quarters, right? In the temple court of God. According to the books of Kings and the Chronicles, some kings have shown great contempt and despised the ordinance of God concerning his law and his house. One of the stories of King Uzziah, King Ahab, King Uzziah tried to go to God to offer sacrifice before the God. He believed that, you know. God struck him with leprosy. That's the king, you know. Isaiah grew up, you know, to be a prophet. That's when Isaiah time. King Ahab, we know that the prophet John the Baptist, not John the Baptist, Elijah, exactly. Ahab is so wicked, am I right? Mm. So. It was because this that God has to cancel his covenant with their forefathers and put them in exile. Now, having returned, they will remain, they still remain ignorant of his desires, his ways. Desires, ignorant, is the non-understanding, am I right? His desires, what he wants to do, and his ways, how he wants to do it, how he wants to be done. Amen? Hallelujah, hallelujah. Even so, God did not intend to bring them into a continuation of poverty and disarray, or to have them remain in a state of ignorance, despair, and hopelessness. His intent was to restore them and bless them. What is intent? Hallelujah. Bless them and restore them. Make them to be a glorious people. Amen. Hallelujah again. A blessed people. This is the main message of Haggai and Zechariah. He called them back to work on rebuilding his temple and encouraged them with wonderful promises. They are, as we discussed, spiritual in nature and were relevant to our time. Hallelujah, hallelujah. If in the former years in our group, I should see our people,
God has been patiently illuminating, bring our heart in alignment with his vision, am I right? In the days to come, he said, I'm going to do this. I'm really going to do it. And the teaching God is going to have such impact in the heaven as well as earth and in individual lives. It will be distinctly consequential. Because God don't care what man thinks. It's not that he is angry, but he has a work to accomplish. He wants to do something. He sent prophet messages, warnings, or instructions to the people in the days of exile, and right, Babylon exile, come back in God. He is sending his voice, same prophetic, with more intense, more trumpet calls to our generations. Therefore, to many who still defiant about this call, God will say, you have no excuse. You have no excuse. That's not it because it's angry. It's just said, you have an excuse when I choose my people to move on with them. And you are excluded. Let me say it again. You are excluded. Those who serve God, those who don't, they're going to have a distinction. And God wanted him to be served in our own ways, in our own light. He wants to serve in his own intent, in his own desires, his own ways. His own order. Hallelujah. This is sounds, you know, many years ago, when we heard this message, we all get excited. Today, I think we begin to have some sober minds about it, and a sense of fear, because it required a lot on our part to make the right kind of choice in following God. At this world moment, Ben rise up and pray for us. The Lord is not merely in the business of convicting us. The Lord is inviting us to believe in him so that he can move and do mighty things on our behalf. Am right? His eyes look and through. He found to find those who have a heart to understand. And he will do mighty things on their behalf or through them. Go ahead. Hallelujah. That's his intent. That's his intent. But he will not blur or make people have their own standard. He has to be very pronounced, declared, make sure his standard is raised up and apply. Go ahead. Pray for this.
Amen. Oh Lord, may our hearts be found pure and worthy, Lord, willing before you. Lord, as you set about to accomplish mighty things, Lord, may we be found willing and washed clean, Lord. Mm-hmm. Lord, it is with great soberness, but with great joy.
Yes.
That we look forward to the mighty works of your hands, Lord, in the earth, in your people, Lord, in us. Lord, you have called this generation as one to do your work. So, Lord, may we not shrink away or delay or have false presumption of our own ideas, Lord. But may our eyes be further opened. Lord, clear the path, clear the way that we may see. Lord, even if it is just one step at a time, Lord, we ask that you guide us. We want to be faithful and obedient to your will, Lord. Lord, bless those that are obedient to you.
Yes.
And raise up those that would be faithful unto your word and your way. And may those people be even us. We thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Let's continue. Hallelujah. It's 10:10. Thank you, Lord. Balala Sandana Yala Daba. Amen. Hi, guy. In order to see this more clearly, let's take a look at some scriptures. Hi, guy 1, 2 to 12. Brett, can you read for us 1 to 12? The 2 to 12.
This is what the Lord Almighty says. These people say, this time has not yet come to rebuild the Lord's house. Then the word of the Lord came through the prophet Haggai. It is time for you yourselves to be living in your paneled houses while this house remains a ruin. Now this is what the Lord Almighty says. Give careful thought to your ways. You have planted much, but harvested little. You eat, but you never have enough. You drink, but you never have your fill. You put on cloths, but you are not warm. You earn wages, but only put them in a purse with holes in it. This is what the Lord Almighty says. Give careful thought to your ways. Give up the mountains. Go up into the mountains and bring down timber and build my house, so that I may take pleasure in it and be honored, says the Lord. You expected much, but see, it turned out to be little. You have brought home, I blew away. Why, declares the Lord Almighty? Because of my house, which remains a ruin, while each of you is busy with your own house. Therefore, because of you, the heavens have withheld their dew, and the earth its crops. I called for a drought on the fields and the mountains, on the grain and the new wine, the olive oil and everything else the ground produces, on people and livestock and on all the labor of your hands. Then Zerubbabel, son of Shealtiel, Joshua, son of Jozadak, the high priest, and the whole remnant of the people obeyed the voice of the Lord their God and the message of the prophet Haggai, because the Lord their God had sent him. And the people feared the Lord.
In this scripture, you can see that the Lord was not happy with the vision and the life the people had at that time. He had to encourage them to come back to his plan. Similarly, the Lord revealed his desires of way to Zechariah so that they would not miss out on his intent. Go ahead.
This is what the Lord Almighty says. Now hear these words. Let your hands be strong so that the temple may be built. This is also what the prophets said who were present when the foundation was laid for the house of the Lord Almighty. Before that time, there were no wages for people or hire for animals. No one could go about their business safely because of their enemies, since I had turned everyone against their neighbor. But now I will not deal with the remnant of this people as I did in the past, declares the Lord Almighty. The seed will grow well. The vine will yield its fruit, the ground will produce its crops, and the heavens will drop their dew. I will give all these things as an inheritance to the remnant of this people, just as you, Judah and Israel, have been a curse among the nations. So I will save you, and you will be a blessing. Do not be afraid, but let your hands be strong. This is what the Lord Almighty says. Just as I had determined to bring disaster on you and showed no pity when your ancestors angered me, says the Lord Almighty, so now I have determined to do good again to Jerusalem and Judah.
Hallelujah.
Do not be afraid.
Do not be afraid. Amen.
These are the things you are to do. Speak the truth to each other and render true and sound judgment in your courts. Do not plot evil against each other and do not love to swear falsely. I hate all of this, declares the Lord. This is what the Lord Almighty says.
Now, that is very important to read it 16 and 17. Because that's a tradition. That's evil people do. That's the cultures around them do. That's the Babylonian people do. That's the Samaritan people do. But not the people who has the law and the righteous God in their heart. And they need to deal fairly and with their neighbors. Amen. Hallelujah. And this social justice started from individuals. So God demanded the people to treat one another with fairness, with good, with love. Amen. And he said, refuse to continue to be contaminated by the culture of the world. Not lie to us what that means. Are we continue to have the world, its competition, is a lie, is deceit, is perverted way to tell us how to do our business, go about our careers, go about our relationships. That's a choice. Amen? And all we want to work decently with decent people, doing something, maybe simple to start with, but solid, am I right? Doing right. This world is like a fast food mindset. Quick rich, big money, big fame. Everybody wants the fame. And some 30 young people flourish for the moment, quickly cut down. And some YouTube personality recently I heard. Mm-hmm. And the life is so deceived. It's not that we don't need to be famous, we don't need to do certain have opinions. But what you can garner through those ways of building life. Mm-hmm. You have the whole world is following you, what are you doing? So what? What is in your heart? What is really going on with you, yourself? We have certain reality shows showing the foolish lifestyle of certain people, am I right? We're enamored about it. I don't want to hear it. Not that we are interested in good things, just have movie, drama, art. But this is a speaking loud, not the actors about it, speaking loud the will of the world. And that's a culture that we can blame those who feed those things, but the desire is in the people, in each one of the people. They pay for it, they build, they give endorsement to those things, am I right? Hallelujah. And God understands this infiltration, you see, for his own people. So he said, no, you need to start working your own ways out. Don't give in to those things, read of those things, then come back to do things, do life right, am I right? Do life right. And don't need to suffer under them. Excuse yourself from them. Build something new with your own people. I'm not saying businesses, practice, careers. I'm talking about spiritually speaking, spiritual mindsets. Amen. Hallelujah. Who is your family? Who is your collaborators? Define it. Who is building the house of the Lord with you? Are you building the house of the Lord to begin with? Amen. Hallelujah. Those are simple questions you need to ask. Basic questions you need to ask. Amen. Is this a heavy message? Oh, this is what we called for. This is why we give our life in certain pursuits. And right, what has been about? Amen. Hallelujah. But when we start doing it, the heart is settled. So that I will do it. And the call is here, and the work is before us, and God is waiting for long. He's going to move. There's no more waiting. Hallelujah. There's no more waiting. Amen. God is going to do it. They will commit to do it. Amen. Hallelujah. Those who don't, they will find every kind of excuses that this is not it. Amen. Hallelujah. No, God will not do it. No, God is still going to wait for us. For me, particularly, so that it can be done with me. Those are foolish thinking about. You know, that's a pride, am I right? That's fundamental attitude of pride. Unfit for the holy work of God. Amen. That being said, go on, please.
This is what the Lord Almighty says. Many peoples and the inhabitants of many cities will yet come, and the inhabitants of one city will go to another and say, let us go at once to entreat the Lord and seek the Lord Almighty. I myself am going, and many peoples and powerful nations will come to Jerusalem to seek the Lord Almighty and to entreat him. This is what the Lord Almighty says. In those days, 10 people from all languages and nations will take firm hold of one Jew and by the hem of his robe and say, let us go with you because we have heard that God is with you.
God is with you. God is with you. Is there a similar calling being sounded out to us as remnant God's people today? Yes, as I shared, loud prayer. Let us heed the pattern given by the Lord. Forget what is behind us and rise up to take His divine and most gracious calling to us as a people and as a generation. Let us build His house first, then attend to our own business. We can't do this other way around and expect Him to bless us. No, He will not. But if we follow His word and pattern, He will always bless us. It's a desire, it's a purpose to bless His people, a people who know Him and love Him according to His ways, a people who possess His wisdom and His love. What is the glory of God for us as a spiritual people that He has raised up as willing to prosper? A people with godly wisdom and godly love. Such a people are His glory. Amen? Is His glory. Those who have received their King and become His covenant people. This is the prophetic promise that is given to us through Zechariah. Allow me. Zechariah 9:9-10:2 said, "Rejoice greatly, daughter Zion. Shout, daughter Jerusalem. See, your King comes to you, righteous and victorious, lowly, riding on the donkey, on the colt, the foal of the donkey. I will take away the chairs from Ephraim, the war horses from Jerusalem. The battle bow will be broken. He will proclaim peace to the nations. His rule will extend from sea to sea and from the river to the ends of the earth. As for you, because of the blood of my covenant with you, I will free your prisoners, set the free, from the waterless pit. Return to your fortress, all you prisoners hope. Even now announce that I will restore twice as much to you. I will bend Judah as I bend my bow and fill it with Ephraim. I will rouse your sons, O Zion, hallelujah, against your sons, grace, and make you like a warrior's sword. Then the Lord will appear over them. His arrow will flash like lightning. The sovereign Lord will sound the trumpet. He will march in the storms of the south, and the Lord Almighty will shield them. They will destroy and overcome with sling stones, as with David against Goliath. They will drink and roll as with wine. They will be full like a bowl. It will spring the corn of the altar." That's a priest to offer sacrifice. Right? So there's a king and there's a priest. The Lord, the God, will save the people on that day. As a shepherd saves his flock, they will sparkle in his land like a jewel in the crown. All attractive and beautiful they will be. Grain will make the young man thrive, and new wine the young woman. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Well, when the people don't see this yet, they will think it's a dream. That's never going to happen. God cannot do that for us. The term is me, I have a sound in my heart. God will do it, everybody. He will do it. Hold on to it, and He will do it. Do it especially for you. I'm talking about all kinds of blessings will be yours. Do it the right way. Psalms 126. 'When the Lord brought back the captive to Zion, we were like a man who dreamed. A mouth filled with laughter, our tongues with sounds of joy. Then we said among the nations, the Lord has done great things for them. The Lord has done great things for us. And we are filled with joy. Restore your fortunes, O Lord. Like streams in the gate, does the land will kill and possess. That's the word wine was brought, you know, the grapes and wine was brought back. That's where Davies resided. That's a special portion to give to this house. The best land. The best of the land. Streams in the give. Remember, Caleb has to bless his daughter with the upstream, downstream, stuff like that, you know. The daughter has to say, hey, give me land, but the land's not enough. Give me the stream. Give me the stream. Those who sow in tears. That's us! Hallelujah, that's us! Yeah, sow in tears. We'll reap with sons of joy. Now, who is the harvest we have? The harvest, I say, Elaine's harvest. Noah's harvest. Your children's harvest. Amen. God's people is the true harvest. But much more. Because we have, he has changed us, you bless us in every way. I tell you, he goes out weeping, like Naomi, isn't right? Can receive the soul, but return with songs of joy, carrying shelves with him. Hallelujah. I think Cheryl there, the Lord told me to have Cheryl to pray for us. He said, the Spirit upon her. Be blessed, my sister. God is mindful of us. God knows what he's doing. Amen. The enemy will try to scatter, try to discourage, but he will not able to succeed. Our God will succeed. Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord. God, I thank you for your Spirit. I thank you for your grace. I thank you, Lord, that you hold us as the beloved of your heart. Lord, I praise you for your victory. God, I praise you that we are part of that victory, Lord. I agree with this cry of our hearts coming forth this morning, Lord. Let us be pure. Let us be wholehearted. Let us be prioritizing your house, God. Thank you, Lord, that in every moment we can choose that. We can choose that, God. Let us indeed rise up as mighty and strong for you, no longer distracted or tossed around, Lord, but walking in the reality of the victory that you have called us to walk in, Lord. It's not us that will be overtaken, Lord, but it's the one in this world who has already been defeated by the blood of Jesus, the blood of the Lamb. Thank you, Lord. Let us rise up in strength, God. Yeah. Let your house be built. Let your purpose be carried out in our midst, Lord, in our lives, through our children, through our decisions every day. I pray, oh Lord, that you would find a place for yourself in us, oh Lord. A place worthy and suitable to be called your home. Thank you, Lord.
Our faith is not stumbled. Amen. Be convicted, the truth is not pride. Let the devil be silenced. Amen. Hallelujah. I go on with this teaching. Some will ask, hasn't this prophecy already been fulfilled by the people who returned from Israel, by the Lord Jesus himself when he came to the Jews? In a sense, yes. But there's also clear evidence that historically the Israelites never found the fulfillment to the extent God had promised. This is because their fulfillment is meant to be ours and the spiritual people of God. Also, in the Spirit and by the Spirit. As we explained in the first session, God is building us into His heavenly temple as a living stone by the work of the Holy Spirit. This is the main theme of the gospel of the Lord Jesus, preached and passed on to these believers. They followed Him because they believed that the teachings of the Lord were granting them eternal life and paving the way for them to be included in the house of God, the Father, in heaven. It was for this reason Peter, John, Paul, and many others gave up everything on earth and became His disciples. And they laid the foundation of work that we are invited to take up and be part of, in order to affirm that it's also the calling God unto us as His remnant people today. Let's continue to study more of the revelation given to Zechariah. Zechariah 6, 9 to 15 said, "The word of the Lord came to me, take silver and gold from the exile, Haldiah, Tabijah, and Judiah, and who and the right from Babylon, go to the same day to the house of Josiah, son of Zephaniah. Take the sword and the gold and make a crown, and sit on the head of the high priest Yeshua, son of Zadok. Tell him, this is what the Lord Almighty says. Here is a man whose name is the branch, and will branch it out from his place and build the temple of the Lord. It is he who will build the temple of the Lord, and he will be clothed with the majesty, which is honor, glory, and will sit and rule on his throne. And he will be a priest on his throne. And there will be harmony between the two. The crown will be given to Haldai, Tobijah, Judiah, and he's the son of Zephaniah, as a memorial in the temple of the Lord." So it's another thing, Emrah ended, to all the other artifacts, the holy vessels, Emrah instruments in the house. Amen. These, those who are far away, will come and help to build the temple of the Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah. And you will know that the Lord Almighty has sent me to you. This will happen if you diligently obey the Lord your God. Amen, hallelujah. In essence, the Lord renamed Yeshua as a branch, which is a prophetic name for the Lord Jesus. He's a branch from Isaiah 11, 1 to 2. Amen. In Hebrew, the name of Jesus actually is Yeshua or Joshua. Now, Joshua, during this time, had only been styled as a high priest, but not also as a king. You see that? Then we may ask, how will harmony come between these two offices? What are they? Well, evidently, there are two offices. One is kind of a priest, the other is kind of a king. That's why, as the prophet mentioned, he is a priest sitting on the throne. This is also clearly seen in Zechariah, the book of Zechariah, in the same book, in 3 chapters, 3 to 10, said, "And now Joshua was dressed in filthy clothes, and he stood before the angel. The angel said to those who were standing before him, take off his filthy clothes. Then he said to Joshua, see, I've taken away your sin, and I'll put fine garments on you. And I said, put a clean turban on his head. So they put a clean turban on his head and clothed him while the angel of the Lord stood by. The angel of the Lord gave this charge to Joshua, angel messenger. This is what the Lord Almighty said. If you will walk in obedience to me and keep my requirements, then you will go in my house and have a charge of my courts, and I'll give you a place among this standing here. Listen, High Priest Yeshua, you and your associates sitting before you. You are men, symbolic of things to come. I'm going to bring my servant the branch. See, the stone I've set in front of Yeshua. There are seven eyes on that one stone, and I will engrave an inscription on it, says the Lord Almighty. And I will remove the sin of this land in a single day. In that day, each of you will invite your neighbor to sit on your wine, under your wine and the fig tree, declares the Lord Almighty. It's basically they flourish, right? They prosper. You see, it's a prophetic act. We're speaking of things to come. It is pointing out a part of the office that quiet Jesus was to be installed into. That is, his heavenly priesthood. The other part of office is his kingship. In the same vision, the kingly office is represented by Zerubbabel. Let's continue reading. So the same vision, right? Divided by chapter, but it's the same visitation. Then the angel who talked with me returned from 1 to 14, chapter 4 of Zechariah. The angel of the Lord talked with me, returned to woke me up, like a man, someone awakened from the dream, from a sleep. He asked me, "What do you see?" I answered, "I see a solid gold lampstand with a bowl and top, the same lamp on it, with seven channels to the lamps. Also, there are two olive trees about it, one on the right of the bowl, the other on the left." I asked the angel who talked with me, "What are these, my lord?" He answered, "Do you not know what these are?" "No, my lord," I replied. This is said to me, "This is the word of the Lord to Zerubbabel. Not by might, not by power, but by my spirit," said the Lord Almighty. "What are you, mighty mountain? Before Zerubbabel, you will become a level ground. Then you will bring out the capstone to shouts of God bless it. Grace upon it," in other words, right? "God bless it." Then the word of the Lord came to me. "The hands of Zerubbabel have laid the foundations of the temple. His hand will also complete it. Then you will know that the Lord Almighty has sent me to you. Who dares despise the daily small things?" Amen. Let's hold up our hand. Lord, teach us to value what you value and commit to what you want us to commit to, Lord. In heart, in spirit, in choices of life, Lord. In the intent desires of a deep being, Lord. In the past, we don't see, we didn't hurry with. We will say, "I don't know what to do. I don't know what to commit to." But from this day, this hour, allow us to be the elected ones, the set of stones, the chosen vessels, the honorable ones in your sight, Lord, sparkling like a jewel on the crown. Lord, make us holy as you are holy. Continue to forgive us, continue to enable us, continue to perfect us, Lord. But let our heart be set on this one thing, even your desire and your ways, Lord. For your people. Let's continue to expand our life to be used by you as a broken bread and poured out wine, Lord. Because none of us remain but you all in all. Thank you, Father. And bless my brother and sister. I know their hearts are willing. I know that this is a weighty and sober thing. It's good to have the fear of the Lord. Thank you, Father. The world despises it. Man tried to cheer us off, cheapen us in terms of ways to worship you. But we know who you are. That we need to be sober-minded sons, mature ones. Know the responsibility and entrustment. Know the value and the honor and the mighty call that you reveal to us. For this we will not excuse ourselves. We will not give in to others' foolish thinking concerning the soberness of the moment, the solemnity of the occasion, and the weightiness of the call that they entrust me. Give us what we need. Give us what we need, the weight of your glory, may it fill in our temple, Lord. Amen. I bless, I ask you for visitations. I know you have sent angels ahead of us. I ask them to do mighty bidding. I give them freedom to reveal and do things. This is the day, this hour. Show yourself. Be strong on God's behalf. Show yourself be the faithful helps of the sons of God. Thank you, Father. I pray for evil to be tumbled, at least subdued in our heart, on our feet, a spiritual feet, as we abide in you. Lord, honor us as you honor us, and despise the things of us, Lord, as you despise us, so we be made clean. Hallelujah. Help us in our weaknesses. Help us in our undecisiveness, undecided things, Lord. But only you can do it. It said, the word said, not by mind or power, but by your spirit, Lord. Mm-hmm. So send your spirit, be it more than a teacher for us, but an enabler, Lord. Enabler for us. The true anointing that has a priestly wisdom and grace, and a kingly wisdom and grace. With it, the service thereof, Lord. Thank you, and the joy of a harvest thereof, Lord. Give us that joy. Give us that peace. Give us that righteousness. Give us that boast. We will boast in a mighty God, what he has blessed us. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. 11. So, I asked the angel, what are these two olive trees to the right and the left? The lampstand. Again, I ask him, what are these two olive branches besides the two golden pipes? Then pour out golden oil. He replied, do you not know what these are? No, my Lord, I said. So he said, these are the two who are anointed, amen, who are anointed to serve the Lord of all the earth. Now, what are the two offices and the two related services that will serve the Lord of all the earth? The priesthood and the kingship of Lord Jesus Christ. He will rule in this capacity to impart the kingly and the priestly wisdom to his people. We may ask, are this done only by him, or did Jesus pass them on to the disciples when he consecrated them into his service for God the Father? The answer is, he has passed on to them and also on to us as the chosen people. This is a mystery that the author of the Hebrew tried to expound. Obviously, the people was addressing, was facing trials, persecutions, they seemed to have forgotten why they were called. And what the faith has been given to them would attain. So he boldly, talking to the author of Hebrew in the book of Hebrew, so he boldly and sternly warned them of the consequences when they attempted to turn away from such a high and a glorious calling. We may first ask, when Apostle John spoke of the work of the Holy Spirit and the wisdom that true believers are to be invited to fellowship with, were not he speaking of the same things? That is, the priestly wisdom and kingly wisdom the Father always wanted to give his sons as their inheritance? Yes, yes, he was speaking of these very things. Let's take a look. 1 John chapter 1, 1 to 3 said, that which was from the beginning, which have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which have looked at and our hands touched, this we proclaim concerning the word of life. The life appeared, and we've seen it and testified to it, and we proclaim to you the internal life, which was with the Father and made known to us, appeared to us. Amen? The word appeared, right? Revealed himself. We proclaim to you that what we have seen and heard, so that you may also have fellowship with us, and our fellowship with the Father and with the Son, Jesus Christ, who is in heaven. Hallelujah, from above. You see, he did not present an earthly fellowship to those he was to disciple and love. What is fellowship? A heavenly, spiritual fellowship. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. One denomination. One name. One God. One Father. One Lord. One faith. One hope. One body. One spirit. One really. Hallelujah. Anything challenges is from the Antichrist. Should we see it? It was the heavenly family of God. Meaning was said, yes, I believe. Yes, I think it's wrong to have those things. But your agreement is not good enough. You need to drop everything, come into the fellowship. That's what the real call. Acknowledgement, agreement means nothing. That's not harsh, that's the reality. I agree, America's a good land. But I never step into the land myself. Never eat the food. Never see the beauty of the land. Never interact with the people. What good for me to say that America is a blessed nation? The kingdom of God is the same way. The house of God is the same way. Amen? Hallelujah, hallelujah. You see, John the Apostle did not present the earthly fellowship to those who held he was the disciple of. Amen? Hallelujah. It was the heavenly family of God on whose table, amen, the life of Christ is to be the bread and the wine. The koinonia, the fellowship, right? Continuing in the communion. Continuing in John. John, 2nd chapter now, the 1st John, 2nd chapter, 18 to 28, allow me. He said, something had to happen in order to enter into this. Do not allow the world or anything in the world. Hallelujah. Do not allow the world as a whole, the cosmos, am I right? This age, the enticement of this age. Or anything in the world. Anything in the world. Oh, I don't love the world. I think in the past, so it's a filthy wagon wrap it up. But I like the donkey in it. The donkey will remain, many Christians say. I don't like, but yes, this world wrap up. But my grandma will be there. We shamelessly claim, right? What your grandma really embodied for you? Let me ask. What your grandma really means to him? Then the Lord said, I have better things. Mm-hmm. Then the Lord said, it never filtered through my teachings. Have you asked me? Is it truly the vision I gave to you? Truly the visitation I gave to you? Because I died, you see? They will not appear to you until I enable them, make them alive, am I right? That's the Bible. That's the Bible. The Spirit will all raise up, am I right? Then we have all goes through judgment, am I right? So, I don't know what Bible you read, but according to my Bible, the final judgment we render announced, then the spiritual life come from sleep. Have awareness, have consciousness, am I right? They instantly caught up and going to come back with the Lord, am I right? Revealed to the creation. That's the Bible. So may we ask, what experience you have? Who enticed you think the things this world supposed to continue going your future blessings? Who told you the way of the world is going to be imputed to the internal reality? That's a lie. I'm not saying we don't love our grandmother, we don't appreciate our grandmother, I'm talking about I'm talking about a totally different thing. No matter what wisdom, what vision, what spirituality really engaging. How you then posture your spiritual life to begin with. We all need to be saved. I believe everyone calling the name of the Lord to be saved, but you save into what? Amen? Hallelujah. Huge difference. There is a false gospel. There is a half-cooked gospel. And it's not the gospel the Lord proclaimed. That's my point. And we need to be very aware of it. It's enticement. It's a feudal reality. It's appealing to our soul. Anyone who loves this world and anything in it, do not do it. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. They are incompatible. Last time, I think it's through the few sessions I said, there is a false message this day, and they're going to offend many who think they are serving God with a purpose. When we said, examine the way of your love. Examine what love you're talking about. You're forgetting. Amen? Hallelujah. You see that? The disciple of the Lord, all talking about the absoluteness to done with the word of the love. Am I? Self-love. It has to die to that. The unwise teachers, though they think they represent God's love, they said, you don't need to do that. It's just bridge in. Shift in. No, it needs to be the death until God give you back. Amen? Hallelujah. We can love as He loved. Amen? Right? We can respect, love, cherish others as He loved. In the order He prescribed us. Amen? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And this is a challenge for Jesus, for Peter, nonetheless, for us. Amen? Right? So, should be. If you never go through such struggles, you said, I'm ready to proclaim God's love. You know, I will have to stand back and say, let me see the struggle first. Have you been taught and filled up by the will for love of God? Then, right, the substance of God's love. What can fellowship you are trying to build for the host of the Lord? Or introduce it? Amen? Where is the foundation? Where is the capstone? Where is the pattern of this building? What the spirit you love. Amen. Hallelujah. I not try to criticize people. I want to reveal the truth to us. What God invites us to do. Amen. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. Period. That's how you balance. Period. For everything in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of this life, comes not from the Father. He gives the root, the fruit diagonal. Not from the, but from the world. If it's from the world, period, it's not for God. If fellowship introduces to me, I need to be very aware of it, right? Especially when I idolize the things, put the things as a must-have in life. The world desires, pass away. But whoever does the will of God, what's the qualifier here? Do the will of God. As a son, right? You can't do the will of God in this context without sonship. Lives forever, eternal life. Dear children, this is the last hour. This sounds harsh, worse when it's speaking by a person like me, Imran. But thinking about it, it was not my word. It's Jesus' word, it's John's word, it's Peter's word, it's Paul's word. It's not my word, Imran. It's already my word. Did I try to put my word in John's mouth? So hard to swallow him, right? But this is the truth. This is the life. This is what disciples were meant for them. this is what service meant for them. It's hard. Narrow the path, narrow the way. But hey, you gain everything, God. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You gain everything. The cross has to finish the work in us. Amen. Hallelujah. Has to be done. Dear children, this is the last hour. And as you have heard that Antichrist is coming, even now many Antichrist has come, have come. This is how we know that is the last hour. Do you, how we know it? They went out from us. That's the last hour. Deception, right? Basically deception. That was Jesus warned. In Matthew 23:24. They will proclaim his name, but they refuse to enter into the truth. They will present to you a different teaching, a different fellowship. Amen. And John knows it very well. He said, they went out from us, but they don't really belong to us. They don't really belong to us. That belong means family, and right? The same family, the same true fellowship. But they come out from us. The weeds, right? With the wheat or whatever, the tire of the wheat, the story. Now, it sounds we are creating pointing fingers. No, I'm just expounding the scriptures. That's happening in John's day, in Jesus' day, and right? In Paul's day. Amen. Hallelujah. How much more we should be aware of these things in our day. And right, so when people like us don't care the authority, you know, the kind of faithfulness and holiness like Jesus and Paul and Peter and John had, and right, when I went through that, hallelujah, how much sober mind we need to have, I think very much so. One prayer I have is in my life, I always need the one, you know, in God. But that's my prayer. When I'm talking serving him, I don't mislead anyone. I'm okay to be rejected. I'm okay to be left alone, right? So, but I will not, for those who believe in me, trust in me, to lead them into a lie, you know, with a lie. Thank you, Father. Amen. Give us that faith. Give us that truthful heart. But not to see I'm trying to be a good, be genuine, be truthful. It's only because I know how bad it can go if I look at it. God will, I don't want to lose my own soul, right? I don't want to, when the Father comes around and say, you sin against them, this, but the one of the greatest sins is you lead another way astray. That I can hear. Right? I can sing this, that, because I know God can be right, right? But if another one deceived through me, lost his soul because of me, I'm down. Any good things, I think, any struggle amount to nothing, right? That's why I refuse to serve the Lord, you know? Just keep my own well-being, Lord, leave me alone. Because the responsibility is so huge. John, pray for us.
Yes, Father. As we talked about one of the Kenyan meetings, Father, as soon shared, there is a great responsibility being a steward in the house of the Lord. Mm. Father, may we continue to learn of this, Father, to seek out you and your truths, Lord. Mm. This rich food being served on your table, Father, transforms lives, Lord. Mm. Continue to transform ours, Father. Cleanse us, Lord. Make us fit for service, Father. Mm. Just pray this in Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name. Amen. 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 19. For if the hand belonged to us, they would have remained with us. But the going showed that none of them belong to us. So the coming and going, right? So John knows what made them go. The love of the world, am I right? Not the love of God made them go. Mm. What made them go? The love of the world. But you have anointing from the Holy One, and all of you know the truth. I don't write to you because you don't know the truth, but because you do know it. Because no lies come from the truth. Who is a liar? It's whoever denies that Jesus is the Christ. Yeah. This person is the Antichrist. What it means Jesus is the Christ? He's anointed one. He was anointed, right? With the office, with the capacity, with the teaching, with the wisdom. With the love that are fully from the Father. With the kingdom that with the authority name God. Am I right? Hallelujah. Such a person is Antichrist. Denying the Father, the Son. No one who denies the Son is the Father. Whoever acknowledges the Son is the Father also. As for you, see that. So he's talking in the fellowship with whom? With the Father, the Son. So what it means, denying Father, the Son, denying the Lord. Denying his fellowship, am I right? Was from God. That's a very, very natural transition in John and his audience's mind, am I right? Today we build different doctrines of it, but that's what the whole letter is about. The letter is about to refute the idea that their fellowship is their own fellowship. And tell people to not scander, am I right? Not depart from the kind of fellowship you try to uphold and establish and uphold. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. May this never be used in our sharing as well. To build a denomination or build a little whatever fellowship we think we should have, am I right? So, no, the only thing is the Spirit, you know, in God's household, in the heavenly realms. God, we all to be sons. John is not putting himself to say that I have to be an apostle and to be a teacher. My fellowship is only one. That's not his heart. He said, the truth matters. Mm-hmm. My fellowship is from that truth, is from that way. And if you deny this, you deny the whole thing. What we have to think about it, what make you astray? What make you in disagreement? Right? What make you? Well, it's the Antichrist, it's the world. Let's talk about it. Because I know who I'm fellowship with. I also know who draws you out. Amen. Hallelujah. And when people draw out, what happens? The people involved get confused. Am I? That's natural. So John is putting a place he has to defend his ministry. Defend his leadership, defend his teaching, am I right? So it was a brilliant place to do it. Amen? Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. I hope you understand. Now, you will have to do this yourself if you're going to serve God. And with all truth, am I right? I'm not talking about serve God without truth. You will serve God in truth, and you will have those kind of contentions, you have those kind of strifes. You're going to have to defend your ministry. Amen? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yeah, 26 said, I'm writing this unto you about... there you go, look at this. But what? I'm writing this unto you about those who are trying to lead you astray. Oh, there is a word pronounced here. As for you, the anointing received from him remains in you. And you don't need anyone to teach you. You know even himself, and right? You know the truth. The Spirit revealed to you. Hold on to it. Don't deny it. Don't be confused. But as his anointing teaches you about all things, that his anointing is real, not counterfeit. Just as it has been have taught you, remain in him. Hallelujah. Is that amazing? If one is not of the spirit, not have touch with reality, these things John is robbing, right? Mm-hmm. But if we pretty we understand that that's exactly he should talk, right? So every word he said I have meaning. He's just the word patient, a godly father, an elder, he tried to reason with the people. So listen, let's come to terms with the truth. Let's see the real division here. Mm-hmm. What's really at stake here? Mm-hmm. Just allow him, right? Such truth and clarity in him. Same time. We all know, we know how often this scripture are used to paint the wrong picture of how the spirit of truth will work among us believers, too quickly, and to the grievance of the Holy Spirit, maybe. Some would use them to justify the presumption that I don't need anyone to teach them anything. The Spirit will teach me. Only the Spirit can teach me. Because the Spirit is teaching me without a proper context, right? A proper foundation, proper culture. Amen? Should I see it? Proper fellowship, in a sense. Seeing that God alone will do that for them. How absurd! You see, then why John, with a heart of genuine concern, even try to warn people to stay in his fellowship? That's a contradiction to himself, am I right? We'll address that in another time, if you have the chance to expound what the anointing really means in this context. For now, let's continue with this topic. With this fellowship and the service in mind, God give us His Holy Spirit, the Spirit of truth and power, and gifted us with the anointing of various kinds. This teaching is not doctrinal reasoning or intellectual arguments. If you could learn spiritual truth that way, the Lord would not need to come to refuse the teaching of the teachers at all in His day. It's pretty much a flu in, right? It will be excitement to them. No, this is a heavenly wisdom, and it confirms us into a heavenly reality that is presently existing and functioning. Such is the calling to the people of God, regardless of their age or the life they have been burdened with. For this reason, we are called out of the world to become, as Peter put it, God's elect, stranger in the world, scattered throughout all corners of the earth, I replace the different regions, who have been chosen according to the foreknowledge of God the Father through the sanctifying work of the Holy Spirit, for the obedience to Jesus Christ and the sprinkling of His blood. 1 Peter 1:1-2. God installed Joshua and Zerubbabel to lead the people to restore the latter halls for the temple of their time. The latter halls, in the Father's mind, is His own house in heaven. For this reason, He installed His Son, Jesus Christ, to build us up, to be His dwelling place by the work of the Spirit. In Haggai, the Lord said, "The silver is mine, the gold is mine." Now, we're God's silver and God's gold and God's precious stones. We've been scattered in some spiritual Egypt or Babylon, those wicked, the wild places of the world, which are the falsity of man. Man made things. But now His holy voice is a calling to us, and His holy hand is a work in us. And we are being forged by Him to become honorable vessels in His household, even becoming the crown of His glory. What a wonderful calling we have received. Hallelujah, bless the Lord. Even so, He starts with small things. The restoration of His house starts with a foundation. In the hands of Zerubbabel, about the earthly stone that lent them hope to an earthly restoration, but the Lord has intended the work in the hand of Christ to be for a greater glory with which is restoring the chosen people to his original plan and intention. This is the glory he has intended for us before the creation of the world, and that he dearly wanted to impart to man when he created him and all things. This glory will fill more than just his temple. It will flow far beyond that. And the wisdom and love of the Father will go up to all lands, and so it be on earth as in heaven, both natural and spiritual. Bless the Lord, our Lord Jesus Christ will restore unto us all things, even our lost glory. Having put everything on his feet, the Son will give his kingdom back to the Father, and the Father will fill all in all. We are more than his temple. Were the living sacrifice on his altar as well. How wonderful is the mystery and plan of God. This is a pattern. This is the work of God Almighty. This is a mission and service passed on by the Lord to the early apostles. This is the discipleship or teaching that will build up the host of God. Amen. Hallelujah. With that, we sum it up. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Anybody there want to pray for us? Let's stand up and pray. Anybody have a need? Lord, we pray for Kitty, Sister Kitty. Her stomach is hurt. Lord, we pray for her healing right now, Lord. Jesus, we pray for Tim and Rachel, the family back in Austin, extensive family. Lord, I pray for peace, joy, and hope, and the spiritual truth, Lord. Spiritual grace. Thank you, Father. I pray for Cheryl and children and Wes and Karen, their children, Lord. I pray for the well-being as well. Thank you for bringing us together today, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you for praying the John. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Father, may I have your hands. Thank you, Father. And have hands. Malana, malana, sanda. Pana, yes. Isini, and ba. Thank you, Father.
Lord God, I bless you for this fellowship. I bless you for these people, for this time, God, for your teaching, for your guidance, for your call, for your work in our midst, Lord. I pray that the seeds that you are planting would indeed bear fruit in our hearts and our lives, Lord. I lift up the children, the second generation, this next generation that you are rising up. Lord, from Elaine all the way down to Isabella, and ask God for your protection over them. Lord, I ask for wisdom and life. I pray that the flames of their love and devotion to you, God,
hallelujah,
explode, Lord. That we could catch their passion, their fire, Lord, and be ignited alongside, Lord. Just pray for your direction for them.
Jesus, we bless you. Sister Kitty, are you there? Pray for us as well. Thank you, Lord.
Yes.
Yes, pray for us. Hallelujah.
Heavenly Father, thank you for this beautiful day. Thank you for all of the blessings that you've bestowed upon us. I pray, Lord, that you would just lift us closer to you. Continue to light our paths as we walk this journey. We pray for your continued favor and protection.
Yes, Lord.
We continue to seek wisdom and discernment from you. We pray for you to speak to us. to open our ears to hear. In your name I pray. Amen.
Hey, amen. Wes, how are you guys doing? Karen, little ones, how are you all doing?
Good. We're preparing. The Pinsons are coming over here in a few hours.
There you go.
Well, it's just, they're called the Pinnacles.
The Pinnacles.
What? I didn't get
it. Joke, kids are running this morning.
Oh, okay.
It's good. I don't know. I guess I forgot my computer at work today, so I'm improvising.
Huh?
No, I didn't miss that.
Who are there?
It's here to buy something we're selling. I don't. Some woman's. Karen started selling off the baby stuff.
Oh, okay. Well, pray for us, and we'll let you go.
Father, we thank you, Lord. We thank you because you are a good father. Lord. We love you. Lord, we give you our very lives. We lay them down for you. Lord, help us to not be distracted. Help us to not choose anything of this world over you, but to choose you, your life. That your life can be raised up, Jesus, in our many membered bodies, Lord. And just as you gave everything, Lord, we give everything to you. Yeah. The fulfillment of your life comes forth in this day. Bless your life.
Use Hallelujah. Us.
Thank you, Jesus.
Amen. Bring our best to everybody. Hallelujah. Give everybody a hug for me. Hallelujah.
I will.
Yeah.
Bless you guys.
Yeah. Okay.
Bless
Lord.
You
all. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
See.
Over there.
Internet's
good. Yeah, we hear some voice behind, but we don't see the face, man. So let's see the face. Who is that?
He's a bridge.
Yeah, the phone is very weird, man.
He's used to learn how to use a seat, man. Huh?
Hey, what's up?
I can see you over here if you want to say hi.
Kobasa! Oh, man. You're pretty high now, so... Are you reaching the city? Oh, wow. Okay, be careful there. Bless the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Okay, see you guys, okay? So, yes. Hallelujah.
Bless
the Lord. Bless the Lord. Amen. Amen. Bless the Lord. Hallelujah. The walls of the dam are broken. I saw the mighty overflow of things in all of you. Thank you, Lord, as you raise up your faith, raise up your heart to Him. He will do amazing things. I see, Brad, I think this is the time. You remember, you know, Weijin, the two guys go to this hidden place on the mountain and knock the rock, use a staff or something like that, then the water release or something like that. I think today, all this very thing, what you're doing, fulfill that. You know, go ahead. You didn't come over, let me lay hands on you and pray. The spiritual eye more and more be open. Can you, is aren't you happy with your mother where she is now? So amazing, all right? There's no doubt anymore, you know? Hallelujah. Child is the blessing, all right? So,
amen.
There's no question on belief, you know? Oh, I don't know, this is trying to be smart, you know? It's just like that. I'm not trying to
be ugly, but yeah. But as she see, you know, she see and she delight, she desire, she found it so good, you know, and beneficial for her. That is a different place. Lord. So are you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you. Jesus, thank you, God. Thank you, Lord. Yes.
Lord Jesus, you are faithful, Lord. You're always faithful, Lord. Lord, in your name we can put our trust. Lord, you are the Messiah and the Anointed One, the Lord. And Lord, all those who put their hope in you, Lord, you said are saved, you said are born, you will be born in them, Lord, and they will have life, and they will grow, and that you would be the head, Lord, of your body. Lord, and you said that you hold on to us and that you'll raise us up in the last day. Lord Jesus, you said that you are the first, you're the last, that you reign supreme. So Lord, we bless your name, we praise you. Lord, we know that, Father, I pray, Lord, that for all of us, Lord, that you grant us increased faith and hope and trust in you, Lord. That you are the one and only name that by all men are saved. And Lord, as your body continues to grow across the earth, Lord, you said that you would make your bride ready, Lord, and that you would have a people, Lord, from every tribe, every tongue, every nation. And Lord, we know that day is drawing near and drawing near. And indeed, the books will be opened. But Lord, because we know you, Lord, we have hope. We have joy. Because on that day, you sit on your throne.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
And so, Lord, we bless you, Lord. We pray, Lord, for each person. We pray for Elaine, Lord, and for that you bless her life, Lord, indeed. And Cheryl prayed that all the children, Lord, those who are to come the next generation, Lord, that you would bless them,
yes,
and encourage them and strengthen and raise them up, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
And so, Lord, we pray for all of us that are gathered here today, for Tim and his family and those that he is with, Lord, that you bless them. And Lord, that you grant your life and repentance and joy and abundance and faith and hope, Lord, to all those, Lord, as well, to all of them. So Lord, I thank you for Sun, Lord. I pray you bless him and encourage him, Lord. And thank you, Lord, that he is a faithful one, Lord, who is speaking to us. And I ask, Lord, that you continue to raise up your life within him as well, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
So we bless you, Lord. We love you in Jesus' name.
Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you. When the Lord told me, you raise up your hand and pray, he will give you a couple of visions. So I don't know if you see one or not. I think they are new ones. Hallelujah. Thank you. You have an open heaven. The Lord is willing to touch and break barriers for you, things you can't help yourself. You said, I want to do it, Lord, I just don't know how to go about it. I feel so pressure, burden. Help me. The Lord said, my help is on the way. My help is here. It is a willing heart matter to me.
with within his heart all grace, all power is given. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Lord, now I ask for supernatural vision, in a sense, intervention, Lord, enlarging on his part. Thank you, Father. I pray the prophetic gift that was stolen or robbed or rusty, Lord, I pray shine like a new sword, Lord. New substance, Lord. Breathe upon it a new fire, Lord. With a new blazing out, Lord. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Now, Lord, vision. Thank you, Father, in the name of Jesus. So understand, one has to walk by the power of the Spirit to overcome all things, Lord. Our best effort, our best mind, our best will still need to translate into a spiritual grace, Lord. It's a spiritual spirit, Lord. Thank you, Father. In the name of Jesus, now, Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. Tell me what to see. Hallelujah. What you see. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father.
I don't really understand, but I saw, the first thing I saw was actually, trying to figure out how to explain it. Mm. There's no context for it. It's almost like a triangular black stone, cut at an angle, but like polished like a mirror almost. It was like I think of like marble, but black.
Okay.
And cut at an angle, clearly cut, clearly formed, almost like a pillar.
Cut in half?
No, it was like three-sided, but then was cut at an angle, almost like, similar to the image that I saw of the man standing on the rocky outcropping.
Oh.
Like when I saw the old man above the clouds, uh-huh. The angle of the stone, there's some kind of an angle there.
Okay.
So there's a tip to it and a base. And then I saw a rusty hinge being worked loose, like basically repaired, basically.
You kidding me? Okay.
So like the idea was that it was rusted and unable to move.
Yeah.
But that there was care being applied to work it
sure.
loose and smooth again.
Well, that's interesting. The Lord taught me to tell you you're going to work that out in your spirit, today as an effect. So that's interesting. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, this black stone is a stone. Let's turn to Zechariah. 3 chapter again, the portion of that. It's a mystery. In the priestly ephod, there are two stones. One called Samim, what is the other one called? Urim. And so the black or white, you have to make a judgment whether a matter is of God's will or not. So you just cast the stones out. The particular method, I don't understand it. But they make a prediction, in a sense, based on that judgment. Cast lots. Peter cast lots to choose which one is the not apostle, right? Mm-hmm. The 11 left. So there are certain ways doing it. But in this place, when God began to translate that in spirit, he going to cast all the black stone. He only give us, so that's why Paul said all the promises in Christ is our yes and amen. So yes and amen actually is like, that's exactly what Paul speaking in other places on the test and approve of the will of the Lord is. So it's translated in this casting stone process. So matter, is this your will? The Lord said, yes, this is my will. And you say, amen to it. So there is yes and amen. There is a counseling process. Now in every matter, you're supposed to go through this process. But in particularly concerning the high priest, his duty, his intention was for the people and even God, right? So this council is not for his own well-being anymore. It's about matters relating to God, relating to the people of God. So this is a holy duty. But in Christ Jesus, all promises are what? Yes, amen. So there is no denial anymore. Mm. Everything is given. It's the fullness of God is given. That's what it means. Mm. So the black stone, the denial, is taken away. Mm. So only the yes stone is remain, right? So that's why you see amen, right? So in Christ Jesus, the fullness of God comes. That's what Paul understood, right? So that's how Jesus taught. Let me say it. So it's a required illumination. But in this place, what is the yes? Yes, even yes and amen, it has different counsels, right? Different ways of impartation. You talk about the seventh spirit. Mm. All spirit is spirit. Now in this place, in 3 chapter of Zechariah, in 8, 7, O high priest, shine your soul in the city before you, who are man symbolic things to come. I'm going to bring my servant the branch of sea. What? It's stone. Mm. See that? I said in front of Yeshua. Said in front, normally we think it's outside his body. We actually said in front of his chest, upon his heart, to bear counsel, right? So these have 7 eyes, 7 facets, right? Hallelujah. Making sense? 7 facets, 7 sides on that one stone. And in grief, what he will do? Hallelujah, you see that? I will in grief an inscription upon it, says the Lord. I will write something on it. That's speaking of writing the counsel, write the law in our heart. Amen? That's why Paul laid down speaking of the Lord's writing in our heart. And I'll remove the sin this land in one day. So sin denied, am I? Black, am I? Mm-hmm. Denied. Separate us, am I right? Mm-hmm. From the grace of God. Mm-hmm. So he was taken away. Mm-hmm. So suddenly one stone remained, am I right? So the fullness of God's blessing.
I had a bookmark.
Is that in God's blessing? Seriously?
Well, just the verse right before it, but yeah.
Is that right? Yeah. Okay, there you go. Now you know. Hallelujah. Pray for us. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Father.
Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we want to have hearts full of belief. We want our faith to be strong. Lord, we thank you for this promise. Lord, for this power that you have. Lord, that you can remove the sin from the land. Mm. Even in one day, that stone that seems immovable, that seems harsh and powerful, Lord, is nothing compared to your power, Lord. We thank you for being a mighty God and for working in our hearts. Lord, continue to do a deep work within us.
Yes.
May we run to it. May we embrace your ways, your discipline. As you work in our spirits, Lord, as you set free the son you've called to yourself. Mm. Teach us this posture. Mm. And may our hearts be postured before you in a way that is holy and honoring to you. Mm. Lord, we bless your name today and we thank you for your life and your love for us. Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Wonderful season coming. He will speak to you in amazing ways.